I'm going to start telling you why I decided to study the language of movies. Well, traditionally, movies have been looked at as pictures, music, genres. However, the biggest revolution in the industry came about when sound was introduced, because the audiences wanted to hear actors and actresses speak. Well, since then, movie speech has become not only a major part of cinema, but just as language in general, it has reflected a symbiotic relationship between language and culture in cathartic narratives that tend to legitimate the experience of individuals through the representation of a range of social archetypes, such as housewives, husbands, lovers, heroes, nerds, jocks, etc. These archetypes, they interact in an idealized English language in made-up situations, which end up echoing American values, political tendencies, and economic situations. Because when we idealize something, it gets tinged with our own ideologies and our way to see the world. Well, therefore, taking a snapshot of the verbal language of movies that stretches back in time is likely to provide a good idea of American culture in the best part of the 20th century and the beginning of the 21st. To start this journey, I'm going to first talk about the communicative functional parameters of variation of American movies to show how they vary linguistically. How is this movie speech varied? Well, these parameters, they were revealed by means of a multidimensional analysis on a corpus of 270 movies of the genres action-adventure, comedy, drama, and horror-suspense mystery movies, released between 1930 and 2019. Corpus design criteria was based in movie literature. The movies I collected, they had to have deserved a mention in the movie guide, 1001 Movies You Must See Before You Die, in which 67 renowned film critics elected the best film in each decade. They had to have been nominated or won an award by the Academy of Motion Pictures, Arts and Sciences, the British Academy of Films and Television Arts, and the Academy of Science Fiction, Fantasy and Horror Films. They also had to have been given subtitles in English. Why? Because by observing this criteria, I tried to make sure I got the movies that most people have seen, because they were either praised by critics or by experts, right? For some reason, they got the attention of the academics. Following this criteria then, 20 movies of each genre were collected by decade, totaling 80 movies per decade, 180 movies by genre, reaching nearly 7 million tokens. The multidimensional analysis framework used to reveal the communicative functional parameters by which American movies vary linguistically was developed by Douglas Viber in the 80s. And it was based on the notion of linguistic co-occurrence proposed by Irving Tripp, Himes, and Brown and Fraser in the 70s. This notion holds that the main difference between texts of different registers is that, well, and what is a register? Any language variety defined by its situational characteristics, including speaker's purpose, the relationship between speaker and hearer, and the production circumstances. The difference between these texts is the presence of sets of different linguistic features. To give you an example, we can say that the verbal language of cookery programs on TV is marked by activity verbs, adjectives, and attributive positions, amplifiers, concrete nouns, discourse particles, and second person pronouns. Whereas if I watch a political show, I'm going to hear language that is marked by agentless passive verbs, cognitive nouns, communication verbs, infinitives, and nominalizations. In this study, the register analyzed is, of course, movie speech. And an important aspect of registers is that recent research, more specifically the book Register Variation Online, authored by Viber and Egbert in 2018, shows that because of the situation and criteria upon which registers are defined, they are not discrete categories with sharply defined boundaries, as we tended to believe in earlier research. Rather, Biber and Egbert suggest the existence of parent registers that may offspring other registers that are often hybrid. This seems to be especially true in cultural products, such as movies and television programs, as they are categorized by different people in these industries, both the movie and the TV industry, as well as by viewers, with the purpose of identifying the movies and TV programs, creating expectations and meanings for them, as well as helping people find their way among the myriad of extant movies and TV programs. Well, the resulting varied and inconsistent categorization of these products has to be dealt with by linguistic researchers. And how do we do it? Well, as I see it, what is surely important in such case is that the main purpose or purposes of the registers, the relationship between speaker and hearer, and the production circumstances, that is, what do I mean by production circumstances? The formats and frameworks for the movies and TV programs we choose to study, what is important is that they are defined and the resulting register categories are consistently and clearly defined, as the researcher in this case will be yet another player in the categorization of these registers. The multidimensional analysis to which the register movie speech was submitted in the study I'm going to present is based on the statistical procedure known as spectre analysis, which allows for the simultaneous investigation of more than 100 linguistic variables in hundreds of texts by discovering simple patterns in the relationship among the variables. These patterns, they emerge from the condensation of the information found in the original separate variables. They are put into smaller sets of correlated variables. These smaller sets, they make up the factors that, once interpreted communicatively and functionally, reveal the parameters of variation and the dimensions in the corpus. As the parameters mark the boundaries of the dimensions of linguistic variation. In a minute, I'm going to show you what I mean, okay? So, in view of this, we can infer that dimensions are linguistic spaces composed of sets of co-occurring variables that naturally exist in the text, but they cannot be systematically grouped by our brains alone, that is, without the help of statistical procedures. As such, dimensions are linguistic constructs that lay hidden in a corpus. We write, we speak, we read, and listen to these dimensions all the time when we, for example, recognize an argument, a planned or spontaneous speech, an official document, but we are not aware of the linguistic features that co-occur in them systematically until we can group them with the help of factor analysis. But once we do it, once we group them in terms of factors, the text in the corpus fall along these factors after being the dimensions, and we have a clearer view of what are the existing linguistic conditions of these texts then. In case of American movie speech, we can say that it varies according to their degree of simulated spontaneity, planned discourse, communication of events, argumentative discourse, expression of stance, interpersonal focus, expression of persuasion, situational focus, and the expression of assessment. These are the parameters that will give us the amount of variation we find in movie speech. What the multidimensional analysis I'm presenting here shows is the degree to which the variation based upon these parameters is affected by movie genre and decade of release of the movies in my corpus. Now I want to share my screen with you. So that you can see a graph. Let's see how it goes. Just a minute, full screen mode. I hope you can see that. Well, in terms of here, what we have are all the dimensions of variation. The first one is simulated spontaneity versus planned discourse, communication of events versus argumentative discourse. The third one is expression of
text. Your screen is black.
My screen is black?
Yeah.
Sorry. I'll try again, Tony. New share.
Before, it was okay before.
It was okay before?
Yeah, just the one before.
Can you see it now?
Yes.
Okay, so now I have to go back to my graph. Let's see if I do the full screen mode, can you see it?
No, it turns black.
Okay, so we'll have to keep it small then. Fair enough. Okay, so can you see it all right now?
Yes.
Okay, great. So the third, I was talking about the dimensions. So the first, I presented the first, the second, and the third, which is the expression of sense. The fourth is an interpersonal focus. The fifth is persuasion. The sixth is the expression of, it's a focus on the situation. And the seventh is the expression of assessment. The genres in these dimensions, they gained a multidimensional profile. And what is this multidimensional profile? For action adventure movies, we can see that they are marked for a planned discourse, the communication of events, and the expression of persuasion. Comedies, on the other hand, they are marked for simulated spontaneity, argumentative discourse, the expression of stance, and assessment. Dramas are also marked by spontaneous discourse, the communication of events, and they have a focus on the interpersonal relationships. Horror suspense mystery movies are also marked by simulated spontaneity, the expression of stance. They have an interpersonal focus, and they are marked also for the expression of persuasion and assessment. Now what I did is I decided to bring to you snippets to give you an idea of how this works in the movies. So the first snippet I'm going to show you is a snippet of Manhattan, which is a comedy by I forgot his name. He's so famous. Well, you can see him on screen right now. Let me make it big. Can you see the movie, Tony?
She's gorgeous.
No. I can see your slides.
Okay, so let me try again. So share screen again. Okay.
She's 17. 42 and she's 17. I'm older than I thought. You believe that? I'm dating a girl wherein I can beat up her father. That's the first time that phenomenon ever occurred in my life. Be drunk, you know, you should never drink. Did I tell you? That my ex-wife?
Your Tina?
My second ex-wife. She's writing a book about our marriage and the breakup.
That's really tacky.
It's really depressing, you know? She's gonna give all those details out of that book. Idiosyncrasies and my quirks and mannerisms and not that I have anything to hide, you know, but there are a few disgusting little moments that I regret. She doesn't for me. You should never let yourself.
Kids
gotta get up and she's got homework. I'm dating a girl that's homework.
Okay, so Manhattan exemplifies a comedy, which is supposed to emulate spontaneous discourse. Spontaneous and argumentative discourse stands an assessment. By contrast, we have Around the World in 80 Days that was released in 1956. And you can see that the dialogue here is a lot more contrived. I will share it with you in a second.
Liza, come on, come back. Henshaw.
Yes, sir?
Someone has been tampering. My telegram pages are all crushed.
Yes, sir. One of the members borrowed it to read about the robbery.
You mean it's been used? And if the move isn't so much for fresh one.
At once, sir.
Professional man, Henshaw, but don't trespass on my good feelings.
Me. Some fellas took their chef's paper. Word of honor. First time it's happened here to my knowledge in 45 years.
That was going to the dogs. Next thing you know, all the members will be talking to each other.
Yes, it's the thin end of the wedge. Oh,
so this is an example of an action adventure with a more planned discourse. The planned nature of discourse in this movie is more apparent. It also communicates lots of events, and this bit particularly doesn't have any example of persuasion, but these movies tend to show some language towards persuasion, because once very often in action movies, one character tries to persuade the other to do something and things like that. Well, then now I'm going to share a screen for you to see these dimensions with regards to the decades, okay? So what we have here, what we can see in this graph is that movies from the 30s till the 60s, they also have more difficulty of hiding the planned nature of their discourse. From the 30s to the 50s, there are marks of argumentative discourse as well, persuasion, and in the 1930s and 40s, we also have some expression of assessment. The 40s get a bit more interpersonal, and the 50s situational. The 60s are a really rare case, and I'm going to show it to you. It's going to be clearer when I show you the 60s in a discriminant function analysis. It is a discourse that is marked by planned discourse and the expression of persuasion, but it is not really unique. It is a decade that has some specificities that I'm going to talk about soon. From the 70s on, we seem to get we seem to be able to, but producers seem to be able to emulate spontaneous speech better. And then we have also movies marked by the communication of events in the 70s and the 80s. In the 70s, there is a bit of assessment. Comedy from the 70s that was very popular, that has got these characteristics. The 90s, again, are very odd, because they are only marked for situation. The 2000s, they are marked for spontaneous speech and stance. and the 2010 movies, they seem to go back in time, and they seem to reveal a bit more again of that plan, of the planned nature of movie speech. They share, so the movies from the 2010 share some characteristics with the movies from the early Hollywood, as we can see, because there are also marks for argumentative discourse and interpersonal relationships. Well, now I'm going to stop sharing this screen with you to start sharing a snippet. Just a minute. I want you to see Mesh, which is a comedy from the 70s that is supposed to be very close to natural speech.
What do you do? Who's been stood in this hospital?
Well, what's the matter with her today?
Look, Mother, I want to go to work in 1 hour. We are the pros from Dover.
Sonia doesn't seem to be able to share this screen. Just a minute.
What do you do? Who's been stood in this hospital?
Well, what's the matter with her today?
Look, Mother, I want to go to work in 1 hour. We are the pros from Dover.
I'm going to get that dirty old man out of this operating theater.
And then give me...
I'm sorry. I'm afraid I am not managed to do that. I don't know why. New shear, perhaps. Let's try again. Nope. Okay, so I'm sorry. So I will not be able to show you this bit of movie, but I can send it to you if you'd like me to. Well, so now let's go on. And I will move on in my presentation towards the linguistic fingerprints, because then these differences regarding the dimensions and the genres and decades is going to be a bit clearer. The aim here is to see whether movie speech is so unique in each of the 9 decades that the decade in which a movie was released can be identified from its lexical grammatical characteristics alone. A positive answer to that will attest to the uniqueness of movie speech on the different decades and or eras of the American movie industry and the influence of socioeconomic aspects and modes of production in the way producers, directors, screenwriters, actors, and actresses represent idealized natural speech. To that end, the factors course that I obtained for the movies in the multidimensional analysis were used as independent variables in a predictive discriminant function analysis using the statistical suite SPSS-23. As we were looking at 9 decades of movies, any classification result above 11%, why 11%? Because I got 100 cases divided by the number of categories, which are the decades, 9 decades, is considered, so this 11, any result I get above 11% correct classified cases is considered acceptable, as it means that above such percentage, the results are not random. Ideally, all cases would be correctly classified. However, as we are working with language, that is very rarely the case. Also, in the case of register analysis, looking at misclassifications closely is as informative as looking at correctly classified cases, because they can tell us how stable or how hybrid the texts within a register category, or not a register category, in this case a variable, a situational variable I chose, are, based on the dimensions. And then, because they are classified purely on lexical grammatical grounds, and I have already done multidimensional analysis, I can see which lexical characteristics we can expect to find in the hybrid varieties. Let me try. Now it's very important that I share this screen with you. Let's see if it works. Can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Okay, great. So these results here, this table, what does this table show? They show, it shows that 31.9% of the movies were correctly classified before cross-validation, and 27.5% were correctly classified after cross-validation. What is cross-validation? It is based on the classification conducted with a dynamic set of functions. A different set of functions is calculated for each text because the text being classified is dropped from the analysis that produces the coefficients. Therefore, there are as many sets of classification coefficients as there are texts to be classified in a cross-validated classification. So the rationale for cross-validation is that when I remove the case to be classified, I reduce bias because it does not influence the model that will classify itself. Well, as you can see, most of the results I obtained were acceptable, to the exception of the 1960s and the 1980s. But should I think they are not good enough? No, because actually, because they were misclassified and I can see where they were, in which other decades they were classified, I can have a very good idea of what is going on in my texts. So what I can see is that the two decades that were better classified were the 1930s and the 2010s. The 1940s also got a very good classification percentage, and this result suggests that for the 1930s and the 1940s, that the stringent censure of the Hays Code coupled with the assembly line production process adopted in the golden ages of Hollywood had a strong influence on the verbal language of movies, which may in turn also explain the fact that most of the misclassified movies from the 30s and from the 40s were in one of these decades, like 22.5% of the movies that were misclassified for the 1930s were classified as being from the 40s, and 26.3% of the movies that were misclassified in the 40s in the 30s belong to the 40s. So we can see the strength of this assembly line method of producing movies, because they really have the same linguistic patterns. In the 50s, however, the censure of the Hays Code wasn't as stringent as it was in the previous two decades, and movie speech became a bit more natural as a result. Note that 15% of the movies released in this decade were classified as belonging to the 70s, where we had that multidimensional profile of simulated spontaneity. However, they strongly resemble the movies in the 40s, with 22.5% of misclassifications falling there. And also some in the 30s. In the 60s, the movie industry had to reinvent itself to try to reverse the dramatic fall in box office returns, which actually started in the 50s, caused partly by the advent of television and partly by the end of the Hollywood studio system. This is strongly reflected in the extremely poor percentage of correct classifications for this decade, when the disoriented effort to make box office results back to the figures reached during the golden age of the industry apparently led to a general lack of language patterns as many of the movies from this decade are classified as being movies from the 40s, 50s, 70s, 90s, and the 30s, respectively. From the 70s, perhaps another reason why the movies from the 60s are all over the board is that the general atmosphere of the decade, which witnessed the emergence of hippies, free love and rebellion against social standards and governmental rules, has also affected movie production. From the 70s on, the story is a bit different and they seem to cluster together. See the red numbers. So you have good classifications apart from the 80s, and they are all towards the end of, they are all towards the mid, from the 70s to the 2010s, showing that perhaps a new language pattern has become to emerge there. What happened, when I tried to think of what could have happened in the 80s, I realized that they were highly influenced by the blockbusters of the 70s and also lent this emerging language pattern that started in the 70s to the movies in the 90s. What really struck me as odd though is that in the 2010s, which we saw that which classified my movies as having marks of planned discourse, 58.8, nearly 60% of the movies were correctly classified in this decade, showing that the standardization of language in this decade is really, really strong again. Okay, so what we could get from here is that, let me stop sharing this screen with you. Pause share, okay. So what we really get from all this is that the decades do seem to have a unique language for them, to the exception of the 60s and the 80s. Now, I will give you, finally, yet another perspective on the linguistic profile of American movies across the years, as I'm going to present to you a text type analysis. In this text type analysis, text types are, what are text types? They are defined as groupings of texts that are similar in their linguistic form. The typology is based on sets of syntactic and lexical features that occur frequently in texts, rather than assuming sets of features defined on a priori functional grounds. These feature sets, the dimensions of variation, are identified empirically by multivariate quantitative methods, and the linguistic characteristics of any given text can be specified precisely with respect to each dimension. Cluster analysis groups the texts such that the texts within each cluster are maximally similar to each other in their exploitation of the textual dimensions, while each cluster is maximally distinct from the others. That is, those texts with the most similar dimensions scores are grouped in each cluster. Although an MD text typology draws on a pre-existing MD analysis of the same texts, the end result is very different. In an MD analysis, each text is placed along the dimensions simultaneously, whereas in an MD text typology, each text is assigned to a single text type. We can see this clearly here. So while in a multidimensional analysis, each of my comedies, each of the 180 comedies I have, are simultaneously classified in dimensions 1, 2, 3, and 4, and etc. Whereas if I do text type analysis, the comedy will be classified in a single text time. Okay, so text typology is an extension of MD analysis that complements our understanding of the linguistic composition of texts belonging to a register or to different registers. It shows how text typologies can be approached from either situational or linguistic perspectives, and how the two result in very different perspectives on the organization of texts. Just a minute, because I got, okay. To do a text typing analysis, what I did was I used the SAS statistical package. And I ran in SAS a stepwise cluster analysis performing using PropFastClus. It returns disjoint clusters, which are preferred since there is no reason to assume that there is a hierarchy there. When the clusters are formed, we look at the textual profile of clusters and we interpret them. For each cluster solution, what happens is we get a cubic clustering criterion value. And when I get that, I get a graph like the one I'm trying to show you here. Can you see the graph? I get this graph, and by looking at the peaks in this graph, I decide how many clusters I have. As the highest peak in the cluster is 3, it means that I have no more than 3 text types. Okay, so I ended up with 3 text types, and I had tentative labels for them. The first text type seems to be overtly scripted argumentative dialogue with a situational focus. All the planning that goes into movie speech seems to not be well hidden there. This cluster 2 is spontaneous argumentation with an interpersonal focus, and cluster 3 is the spontaneous communication of events. Let me share because I think it's going to be easier for you to follow. Okay. So, in cluster, what happens with cluster 1 is this. My clusters are this distributed according to the dimensions. So, cluster 1, which is the overtly scripted argumentative dialogue with a situational focus, contains 273 movies, 38% of the movies in the corpus, and 83% of these movies are core movies in the cluster. It is highly marked, as you can see here in the blue, with the blue line. It's highly marked for planned discourse. It's got some marks of argumentation and also a situational focus here in dimension 5. Core movies in this cluster include The Mummy, The Wizard of Oz, All Quiet on the Western Front, Those Magnificent Men in Their Flying Machines, MASH, Schindler's List, From Hell, and Mission Impossible. For you to have an idea of the kind of language that goes into this cluster, I brought you an excerpt of Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol. As you can see, there are lots of nouns and relational adjectives and things that give us an impression that the language was highly planned rather than spoken naturally and online. For cluster 2, what we have is we have a cluster with 217 movies, 30% of the movies in the corpus, and 77% of these movies are car movies in the cluster. This cluster is highly marked for spontaneous, simulated spontaneity, for argumentative discourse here in dimension 2, for the expression of stance. It also has an interpersonal focus, and it's marked for the expression of persuasion. The core movies in this cluster include Mr. Deed Goes to Town from 1930, Gilda, North by Northwest, How to Marry a Millionaire, Rosemary's Baby, Fright Night, Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, which is what I'm going to show you here now, and The Imitation Game. So here we can see that there is a lot more spontaneity with discourse markers. Oh my goodness. Explain yourselves, and then some stance and persuasion. Oh, I thought I could handle it, but I was wrong. So I am kind of Harmonia is argumenting with Professor McGonagall, explaining herself, using an argument, why she shouldn't be so mad at her because she perhaps thought she could do it, etc. So, and finally, cluster three, which is called, let's go to the cluster, spontaneous communication of events. It is highly marked for spontaneous discourse and the communication of events. And the core movies include The Pursuit of Happiness, The Apartment, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Dirty Harry, Beetlejuice, The Shape of Water, and The Conjuring. An example for this movie is, for this cluster, I got the movie Beetlejuice. It is full of action with let's do this, let's do that, lots of verbs. There you go, you don't have to kill anybody, throw your voice, fool your friends. So you see, the movie moves through speech acts, basically. And in this cluster, we have 230 movies, 32% of the movies in the corpus. And 98 of these 230 movies occur in the cluster. Okay, so. Now, if we look at the distribution of genre by text type, what we get is all of the four genres are present in the three clusters. So we can say that the text types are independent of genres. So there is a difference. When I start looking at language solely through lexical grammatical features, I can see that every single genre in the industry has got a portion of this lexical grammar. So they also testify to the tendency for hybridity of American movies. Why? Because in movies, American movies are produced to draw a large audience to the cinemas. So they do on purpose mix a lot of spheres like the romantic, the action, and the drama, and we end up getting clusters like this with every single genre participating in every single cluster. Action adventure movies, they tend to have dialogues marked for planned discourse with a situational interpersonal focus. I'm basing this analysis on the clusters you can see printed there in my graph. Comedy dialogues, on the other hand, are likely to be marked for stance, spontaneous, argumentative, and persuasive discourse, and they have an interpersonal focus. Drama dialogues have a tendency to be marked for spontaneous discourse and the expression of communication of events. And horror suspense movies, they seem quite hybrid. That is, they don't seem to favor the discourse features or foci of any other of the clusters. So in terms of decades, what we get is clusters 1 and 3 point towards a slight diachronic distinction. Movies from the 30s to the 60s tend to reveal to a greater extent the planned nature of movie speech, whereas movies from the 70s onward tend to hide such nature better. Movies produced between the 30s and the 60s also tend to be marked for planned discourse with a situational interpersonal focus. Surprisingly, many movies from the 40s here, they belong to cluster two. And cluster two has a similar profile to those from the 2000s and the 2010s. So that is, they are likely to be marked for stance, spontaneous, argumentative, and persuasive discourse, and have an interpersonal focus. Movies from the 70s and the 80s, they have a greater tendency to be marked for spontaneous discourse and the expression of communicative events. Overall, the typology shows that American movies are relatively stable over time. They are, after all, in 90 years of movies, there are just three text types. They seem to follow pendular trends, because I was really surprised by the movies from the 2010s getting a bit more planned discourse than expected, than the 2000s, for instance. Results also suggest that the more linguistically stable genres are action adventure, cluster one, and comedy, cluster two, and drama, cluster three. So possible applications of these findings are the training of script writers, teaching the major linguistic characteristics for drafting scripts for the different movies. And in ELT, English language teaching, we can see them informing the development of teaching materials to teach students how to focus on the most salient linguistic characteristics of movies. Well, guys, so that's it for me. Thank you. I see I have a bunch of questions waiting for me. If you have any questions I will not be able to answer, you can email me at mass@vedeno@unifesp.br.